Hi, welcome to the 2021-2022 Electromechanical Recovery System Capstone Handoff. I'm going to let the folks introduce themselves, and then we'll do requirements and then go over what they did in CAD and then look at the actual amazing thing that is behind us. Leslie, start with you.
Oh, that's me, the amazing thing that's behind you. Hi, I'm Leslie. What do I say about myself? Senior, graduating, blah, blah, blah. Available for questions later.
Thank you. What you worked on?
I primarily worked on the balut and hardware for the whole ERS system. Anything else? Balut, I think. Balut was big and hardware was big. And prototyping and testing.
Hi, I'm Emma Levy. I worked on CAD and design and assembly for the system. I'm also graduating.
Hello, I'm Jessica Finn. I work on CAD, the machine and assembly.
And you were the project manager.
I was also the project manager.
Hi, I'm Abdulila. I'm graduating also. I work on upper office simulations and deployment guides.
I also work on some CFD stuff.
Good. All right. So, who's driving?
You.
And don't forget to talk loudly so people can hear you on the clock.
All right, we're going to bring up the CAD now.
I thought we were going to.
Oh, we're going through requirements first. Yep. Okay, cool.
So, just as a top level, here's our requirements. Here's what we had to do. Let's just get past definition. So our system requirements is it must support the 100 kilometer flight of an LV-4 class rocket. But in designing, we're scaling it down for LV-3.1 so it can be tested on LV-3.1. So basically keeping in mind that our system has to be scaled up to LV-4, but making everything for LV-3.1. When descending, after we've hit apogee, the rocket can't be nose cone down or long dark configuration during boost and coast. So like when the rocket is going up, it cannot be, the ERS system cannot be in the airstream at all. And it should fit in the nose cone of the respective rocket. It did not. It is longer, but we will go into that later. It must be able to support the dynamic weight of the rocket during subsystem deployment. And it must be able to be assembled by 2 people for LV-3.1 and 3 people for LV-4. It should also be as lightweight as possible, not use any pyrotechnics, use an independent system, and be modular and easy to reset. Cool.
That's good.
And so those are the requirements. So pull up the CAD. Essentially, we designed a system that fulfills all of the requirements except for the should fit in the nose cone and the weight requirement. Those were shoulds anyways, so we didn't actually go down a bounds, but as soon as this loads.
Yeah, actually nothing is in the nose cone right now.
Nothing is currently in the nose cone, but in further iterations, you guys can definitely move stuff to the nose cone. We just decided for time, we weren't going to put anything in the nose cone because that would require us changing our system or possibly changing the nose cone.
I'm dying, sorry. Yeah, it's all relatively very slow today.
Wait, if Ike's grading, it's a 20%.
So this is our system.
Let's start from the top down.
Yes, let's start from the top down. That's the nose cone up there. Essentially, the previous ERS system used, I don't know how to describe it other than the spaghetti monster, but we decided to use springs. So this is 6 springs. You can add more or less if needed. This design is super like changeable. So like if we find out that we need more spring force or anything to LV4, we can definitely change it. Yes.
Yeah.
Right. So this is our whole pop-up system. The idea is that the nose cone and the module below it is a friction pit. And while it's a friction pit, it's held in by those two solenoids. So, and you can show, so that solenoid, it holds in the nose cone to the module below it. And the springs get depressed. So essentially the nose cone gets pushed down until those solenoids get locked in and hold the nose cone in.
Positively locked inside the friction pit.
It's positively locked inside the friction pit. So when the nose cone is connected to the module below it, it's already locked in and it's deformed the amount that it needs to be deformed in order to get the spring force that we want it to. For this, the deformation is set to about, it's deformed by 0.8, and I think that's 100 newtons, or
I think it's 100 pounds.
100 pounds, or 100 newtons, of course.
Will you do me a favor? Will you cut that it right through the solenoid?
I thought of this.
Yeah. Are you through the left plane? Oh, there we go. Nice job.
Like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, perfect.
When should we talk about the shoes at the end? It's conceptual right now.
Okay. So this is just more because we're making changes here, but realistically, this hole will be actually matching where the solenoid is.
Okay.
So that is just not in the crack space. It needs to be a little bit higher up. So
this is one of the last things that we were able to do on the system.
Okay. And so when that whole thing is compressed, it latches out, holds the thing in, mm-hmm. and then the springs are compressed.
Yes. Yeah, and to then, the right amount.
Okay.
Yep.
And then they pop in. And that thing launches off.
Yes.
Okay.
This is where the friction pit is.
Okay.
And then the pusher plate is this ring here that we call the chomp chomp.
Okay.
Because it chomps down. And then this was another design that was actually really helpful from Ed. And so one of the problems that we were having in assembly was keeping the nuts in place. And so this allows us to just put them in there and then when we're screwing it, it kind of holds everything in place and makes that something fairly simple.
Okay, and what if this is all built up in 3D printed form, correct?
Yeah,
it's great.
It's all in there.
Yeah. So this has windows here, mm-hmm. which does the 3D printing, and we just want to be able to see in here and see what we're doing.
Yep.
In reality, it would not help.
Right. This should be ISO grade. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Thanks.
Yeah. This entire system. I believe all is here. I think
everything
that's in CAD is here.
Awesome.
And then this is a part that will probably need to be designed a little bit, but this part that holds the solenoid system. So when we talk about things that need to be changed, I just want to point out that like part of having this track here was because we like weren't exactly able to like figure out exactly where the solenoids needed to go. We want to be able to test different distances. So having that track there allowed us to like change how far they were away from the wall and then like finalize it. After like, if we had enough time to do significant testing and go through it, we could like finalize where that spot was and would have made one that like had that at that particular spot. But for prototyping and testing, it made it convenient to have this track there. Okay. Any questions about the system?
So this is the system that ejects the nose cone and pulls the balut out.
No, I think you're good.
Cool.
Do you want to talk about the balut?
Yeah, I'm gonna pull that out.
Thanks, Josh.
We went through several iterations on Balut stuff. This could be its own capstone, honestly.
Yep.
So we made, this was our first version, and it actually works pretty well. We needed some revisions on pockets and stuff. We tested this in the wind tunnel. Inflation was a little bit wonky. So what we did is we opened this up further, the main inlet, and then we had the pockets all made symmetrical. They were not symmetrical. So this is the new iteration of the Ram Air passive inlet balut. It's made of sturdier fabric, all symmetrical stuff, wider open inlet. I have high hopes for this one because the previous one also didn't rotate in the wind tunnel. So that gives me hope that there's stability in it. I think this would fly well for LV3, and I hope we get to use it.
Black Star bag. Yeah, sponsorship.
So we were talking with Peter about for LV4 using one that has forced air inflation. Mm-hmm. So this is the one that's made for forced air inflation. However, we didn't get the hardware in time for attaching that and making it work. But this is could be a good starting point for testing for inflation.
Good.
For some more context behind the balut. We decided to add a balut to our system. So originally with a two-stage system, we switched to a three-stage system because Abdel and Dylan did some open rocket simulations that saw that like, with LV4 forces, if we didn't add a third stage of deployment, then things could get a little dicey and it have to hold a lot of force. So third stage of deployment is actually a factor of safety.
Yeah, and this is a decelerator basically. Yeah, it's to help the rocket fall as fast and safely as possible so that it doesn't drift away from the launch site.
Yeah.
And then when Droke deploys, like it'll be close
yeah.
to where we launch from, hopefully.
Yeah, so the balut will deploy right after Apogee. And like Leslie said, it'll decelerate to make sure it does decelerate and also stabilize the rocket to make sure it doesn't go nose cone down before any Droke is deployed.
Good. Okay. So the blue is the balut, right?
Yep. Yes. And it's okay. Deployment bag. Yep.
And it's attached to where?
So this CAD doesn't quite show the attachment, but the attachment will be to this.
To that right plate. Here. Okay. Okay.
So this is the other system. This is just the shelf. So 85% of it is made from off the shelf parts. So mm-hmm. You can see behind you that shelf is made right there. The aluminum plates, we all got water cut from Portland Water Jet, and we have a bunch of actually extra aluminum because we only needed one plate to do it. So if people want to do other revisions of those plates, they can. They're all there. We'll show in our Google Drive that a lot of our plates and different components have their own calculators around them that made it decide like what thickness you wanted and how that came to go with like what type of attachments you wanted and the force that could handle everything.
Everything is basically designed to hold 2,000 pounds of force maximum.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that just looking at that though, you can kind of see that about 85% of it is off the shelf. Mm-hmm. I think Leslie, you had to cut the threaded rods, but those all
mm-hmm. it's basically just yeah. cutting them.
Mm-hmm.
And that kind of can help us like hold in our linear actuator, which is another part of our subsystem, and hold that in place. And then for LV4, once we got it to it, we can also attach the air.
This can also be quite a bit shorter. These are the actuators that we found that were in stock and like had the amount of force that we needed. But there are smaller ones, and it can also be changed to like a motor and cam system. But we wanted to stick with off the shelf as much as possible. There are also wedge washers in here to that vibration and it coming apart because it would want to come apart otherwise.
Yeah, so the linear actuator is for pushing a bulky tent. And the bulky tent is basically what's holding our system all together. So
the hex bars or the
Those hex bars are serving to be our attachment points. So all of our attachment points are going to be through those hex bars. So they're screwed into the plates. And we have calculations and everything for like how large they should be, like the thickness. So these like should handle the forces we need to a factor of safety.
At least two.
And those calculations are in your final report?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, good.
They're also, all of the calculators are in both the MathCAD files and like PDFs are in our drive.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can download. Okay. Mm-hmm. There's a couple of Excel ones too.
The mounting of those is actually under, not on top.
Right, yeah. The underneath. That makes sense. Okay. And those hex guys right there, are those for the Balyut or for the Drogue? Okay.
Can you zoom out so we can see the quality change of the Drogue? So essentially, our system works with a ball detent pin holding in a plate, and that plate is going to be what's holding the Drogue. So the Drogue is the dark purple spiral around. It's spiraled around because we realized to just use one ball detent, we need it to be in the middle for symmetry. So that central column, that green tube, gets the bushing of the ball detent gets screwed into that green tube. And the ball detent itself is attached to the purple plate on top. And so that essentially, when the balut is out, that purple plate stays connected to the rest of the modules in the system. So it keeps the Drogue from deploying until it's time to deploy the Drogue. When it is time to deploy the Drogue, the linear actuator will click onto the ball, click the button on top of the ball detent, and basically let go of it. And once the ball detent is let go, the plate is going to come with it. And when the plate is out, the attachment points to the Drogue will pull the Drogue out and deploy the Drogue.
So that aluminum shelf ends up in the Airstream.
Yeah, it's not here, but there are ideas for like making some sort of container for the aluminum shelf to make sure nothing gets too far away out of the Airstream, but it will be connected to the balloon.
Right, so when this goes, that purple plate and the orange part pull out of the thing, right?
Yes.
And pull the Drogue out, and then that's kind of collapses off to the side or something like that. And that's still attached while on Drogue.
Yes.
Okay.
And then another thing I just wanted to point out for like final versus prototype. So we got to the point where because of manufacturing times and different things, we weren't able to get everything in like a reasonable time frame. So we started making things to the point where like whoever takes over can make things resettable. Mm-hmm. So all of these pipes here, you'll see them in there. You can't see them because they have shooting pepper on them, but they are threaded and like they are ready to go. But because in case for some reason people decide they want to do something else with them, we don't have these welded into this plate. We just have basically an insert that they're inserted in and have fastened to. But the idea was that the end would have them be welded.
Okay.
And they're the same material as the plate, so it should be fairly.
It's all
okay. Yeah, and the same grade of Alana.
Or Teresa.
But that's just something that like this little bracket here would probably not be in the final design.
Right.
Yeah, and so below that is the main parachute, purple figure. The ball detent and the linear actuator is on the bottom, but it's essentially the same idea as the Drogue, except for it's bigger and like the ball detent is meant to handle like a larger amount of shock force than the Drogue is.
2,400 pounds.
Yeah.
And then it's 5 times factor of safety on that piece.
Mm-hmm.
Cause that's where the Drogue pulls on.
Yeah.
Okay.
And also at this point, when this plate goes out, the Drogue will be separated from the rest. So it'll just be main carrying the rest of the body, and then the Drogue will carry the balloon and just to make fewer things.
Mm-hmm. And this is modular, so in the case that for some reason the Drogue doesn't deploy, the main can still deploy. It'll just take the Drogue up with it.
Good. I really like that part of it.
Yeah, so each of these plates are about the same. There's a couple of them that make, I think it's the actual plate, they're a little bit of a smaller diameter, a larger diameter, but most of them are supposed to be at the same size, so that way if you had to make them the same, it's just filling the holes that are different. Mm-hmm. if in future people really wanted to enable it, they could make it so that some of them are the same plate and the search rating of how many hex bars are there.
Mm-hmm.
But almost, I think over 7 plates, 5 of them are just the actual. Yeah, and the same thing with these attachments to the actuators. So for the file design, Dylan did make up an Arduino code to control the actuators and to control the solenoids, and it worked, but it's done by a mechanical engineer, which Dylan is great, but I also know that probably any electrical engineer or computer person is going to yell at us.
Oh, that's why I said that was not in your
capsule. In the future, though, there would be like some sort of battery box or Arduino board here. We also have the same system as we have for the solenoids here, so that way we can adjust the height of these. So we were able to test these and show that they did press the button, but in case you want to do further testing, you can adjust this height to decide how far or how close you want it, and then we'll determine the final bracket for
it. Yeah, it works under tension too, which we were concerned about at first, but works.
Okay, so at this point, we've got a fully CADded system, but it's kind of in prototype form. Mm-hmm. And so it's what I would call like Rev 1 CAD, and we've got a prototype of it. So now we can start to go to Rev 2, and then maybe we'll be able to drop test Rev 2. Just real briefly, what would you guys change?
Let's talk about the things that aren't quite working.
Yeah,
let's zoom in on that. So our idea for solenoids was kind of late. And what we had, this idea we had for positive locking for something that was off the shelf was a solenoid. But there are so many, and there are so many that aren't available right now, too. And to meet all of the specs that we wanted for power draw, for the pull force on them, and all of that, we ended up with some that were pretty weak, unfortunately. And we ended up with a 3D printed outside module that we had to drill out, and it's plastic, and it's all reamed out wonky. And so when you press this thing down on top of it, the pin is so much in shear that it basically can't move. Like, so it needs to be much more powerful. And there needs to be like some sort of something that keeps it just moving in an axial direction only.
Yeah, so our idea for that is either stronger solenoids or switch to a cam system, where instead of, other part of the cam system is that instead of like two separate solenoids or however many separate solenoids, it's just all connected to one motor. And so it'll all pull in. Does everyone know what a cam is? It's in the archives.
Yeah. Also, Ed and I were talking, and Ed had an idea for using pillow blocks, basically small pillow blocks to keep it like in. Yeah.
Yeah. So this is an example of a cam system. Essentially, it's all connected to the motor, and when the motor turns, all of the followers of the word, all of the followers will like go out or go in depending on how it's set up.
And this was one of our first ideas that we had for this system. We ended up deciding to not go with it because we just wanted to see if we could do something more off the shelf. But it is like still available, and there's a couple of different iterations of it there.
Good. Is this all in archive?
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. So there's
a lot of
them. Yeah, I was gonna say, so there's a good bunch of stuff in archive. That's good.
Would that
sort of grease? Maybe not grease, but lubrication. Yeah.
And that was the other thing, is like the solenoids, if they wanted to be like looked into more, you could look into finding some sort of lubrication or like a gasket of some sort to see if that would work. But just going off of testing, you'll probably be the stronger solenoid.
Yeah. Okay. How happy are you with the bitey system and the pusher and all that kind of stuff?
Where it is now,
yeah,
I like it. This actually took a second. So lessons learned. Always do fit test. So that was one that took us a while to figure out that in the CAD. So springs and CAD kind of suck. And so one of the things that was hard is that we were modeling the system, and when we printed it, we realized we modeled it for the deformed spring. And so when we put it all together and we like were getting ready to lock it, it was like already locked in its deform case. It wasn't even pushed to its deform case. So we had to go through a couple iterations to like change the measurements to get it exactly where it's locked. And so when we had it in the wrong length, it like was really difficult to assemble. You had to have like clamps and people like pressing down. Yeah. And then now the way that it's assembled, it's like fairly convenient. You don't like, it's very much like one or two people can do it. Versus having several people do it. So the actual clamping system, I feel pretty good about. The one thing that like we looked into, but is gonna probably need a couple more looks is, so in here, if you shine a light in there, you can see the springs. Mm-hmm. I realize, I don't know why.
But people can understand that they're not straight up and down.
So they're kind of like this weird curve there, which kind of makes it so that they're not going to have potentially the same force. Yeah. So like when we did our first round of spring testing,
they're S-curving around the, yeah. Oh,
when
wow.
We did our first round of spring testing, it did that. So then we put the fastener in and it was for a while not doing that. And so I think like either it's somewhere along the lines with different revisions, either we like miss something that's holding in place or it just needs to be tested a couple times, but finding a way to keep those springs more like a straight formation.
Yeah, I think wider shoulder bolts would work too. So just keep it
right there. Oh no, I was gonna say it was the same.
Okay.
I think that the bracket where the actuator hits the button could be tightened up a little bit too, to make sure that it's like right over and it doesn't move at all.
Yeah. So once this got tested and finalized, are like exactly like you want.
Right. That makes sense.
Yeah. Also, the bulky pin itself, how it is right now, it can kind of move in place. Like it's stuck in that position, but like it can twist. I don't know what the word I'm looking for is, but without wiggling.
Yeah.
Wiggling.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And I think part of that is like we made these poles a little bit bigger than probably we needed to, just to make sure everything got through okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so potentially to help with wiggling would be like to make that hole smaller so that we could attach the tape and put pretty stable in there. Or with a racking system, you can see that it doesn't stick anymore.
Yeah.
And that would help. The nice thing about this ball detention is it like already has this opening that you put a bar through, and so we just use it was already there to kind of fasten it in. And I would recommend continuing that idea instead of trying to find a different way to fasten it in.
Yeah, because the loading of that pin is based on the hardware that came with it. So
okay.
To answer your question about the spring system, I like it. I like the idea of it because it's so modifiable. Like you can change the springs, you can scale it up, you can it's easy to swap those things out too.
Okay.
And also like 75% of this is off the shelf.
Yeah.
Like, the only things that are custom are the plate and the, which could possibly also be a little bit less.
Okay.
I'd be curious to see actually if like 3D prints could fly on this too, because it's holding the force just fine.
Yeah, an SLS print might be okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Can you go zoom in on the wiggly bit for just a minute? Yeah, okay, that looks wiggly. Okay, so that'll be somehow redesigned.
Yeah.
Okay.
And also when like this is fully tested, one thing to just make sure is that we tried to make it that things would be flushed wherever the parachute was.
Mm-hmm.
There's obviously like fasteners down here and different things there that are gonna cause it to maybe not be as flush. So in the future when doing testing, just seeing like is even something as simple as like this nut here gonna catch the fabric.
Right.
Which the fabric's pretty tough. So I don't think it's going to be a different problem, but because we weren't able to fully test that part, I think it's worth being noted.
I think we can tap right into
the
circle bits.
We should also talk about helical packing for especially for the main. I think the drogue might fit fine without that much of a problem, but like the helical packing is a kind of a different idea for main packing than usual. So we had a custom 9-foot long parachute bag made out of ripstop nylon. And we tested it to make sure that it would come out of that helical shape smoothly. And it comes out so smoothly. It comes out better than I actually thought.
Yeah, I for the record,
yeah.
I did not think that was going to work.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm hashtag impressed.
Yeah.
And it ends up actually being shorter.
Also, that little bit of extra time out in the airstream before it's fully deployed is going to reduce the shock force.
Mm-hmm. True.
Yeah, so to help with packing
the airstream. Sorry, so does that mean that based on the measurements we've got here, we should be able to reduce the length of all these modules?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And right now, would this fit in the module, in the will the volute actually fit in the cylinder?
Yeah, I don't know yet. We haven't. I just got this yesterday.
Okay.
Yeah.
All
right.
Okay.
Oh yeah. In order to help with packing, because it is a 9-foot long parachute, it has a zipper in it. So it's like the top 2 feet of it is like without a zipper, and you just kind of shove it in and then like put your finger under the zipper so it doesn't get, to make sure it doesn't get, the parachute doesn't get caught in the zipper, and just zip it all up.
But that's also easier than we thought it would be.
Yeah, it was a lot easier than we thought it would be.
Oh, that's great.
Mm-hmm.
Are you talking about that bag right there?
Yeah, the blue and orange one.
Oh, the one is just the zipper.
Yep.
Oh my god.
Packing and assembly.
Blackstar.
Packing and assembly.
Yeah.
We're just packing.
Nice. Okay, that makes it easy.
And I assembled the whole thing in half hour.
What?
The black bag can pop.
Yeah.
That's great.
Did you put the SOP? Yeah, the SOP is in the draft. It is not completed. We need to complete it. But it's KK.
Okay, yes, please. Yeah. Yes, that's important.
For reference, though, Abdullah did put all of this together himself in like half an hour.
That's great. That's good. All right, keep going. I think the bottom part's fine, right? There's nothing. Besides the actuator.
Yes, just a little stability condition there.
Because we know that like the main concern for a lot of folks with this system is the length. And so really, like, I think right now we have a really solid prototype that can go through like various forms of physical testing.
Mm-hmm.
And then once that's done, can we look into like how we make the actuator shorter, how we make some of those different areas shorter. And I think that it will reduce quite a bit of length. But like the
shoe
size,
like these
things right now, but
those are. I think another 6 to 8 inches could probably come off.
Yeah. Excellent. I as much as I like the linear actuators, getting rid of those looks like the main thing to do, and to have some kind of flat. PAM system like you guys were talking
we
about?
We scavenged the old ERS at the very end, and they had a linear actuator that was about this big, and it was the same force as ours.
Oh, really?
We just, yeah.
Okay. So. All right. Good.
Very good.
No, I think we're good. Any other questions or anything? All right. Will you hit the upper right-hand button to make it that picture? Yeah. Yes. Hit it. Thank you. Okay, so where are we? We're go back up a level, please. So in systems LV3.1 recovery. Okay. And that's where you put your that's where we put this. So that we just have to remember it's in LV3.1, not LV4. Okay. All right. So what's in here?
So yeah. So Amber is really great and like a numbering system, so you can kind of see the order of everything there.
Uh-huh.
So
you want to talk about it? I can talk to you. So it's just numbered. The numbers are kind of arbitrary. It's just for ease of like appearance.
Mm-hmm.
So like it said, fall term, winter term, spring term, that's where all of our reports is. Our 0 is our relevant background. So those are links to like the old ERS system, any like papers we referenced, a lot of like the old testing that the previous ERS capstone did.
Yeah.
And then the rest is fall, winter, spring term is basically like all of the reports and stuff we have to do for the class. Rogue information. So all the open rocket simulation we did, all the research we did.
Who's the partnership for the
I think so.
Yes. Well, this is a pretty helpful one. The accelerator entry report. So that's a paper Dylan Miller wrote about like why we should go with a three-stage system versus a two-stage system.
There's like stuff in there about ballistic coefficient. Like it's really, it's a really helpful paper that they did.
Okay. That's in drogue.invaluable. Okay, all right.
It was before we decided to go with the balut. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Parachute stuff is our current parachutes, all of the weights and stuff, descent rates for LV3.1 and LV4, notes, which is like what parachutes we have, the specs they are. Let's go back.
Why are you calling it value? Is it actually called a value?
No, it's a balut.
Okay.
So, huh? yeah, so baluts suck because they're all the research that was done on them is basically been done in the 60s, and not much has changed since then. So finding information about them, that's fine about how they perform or whatever, but how to make them is completely absent. So that's why we had to start from scratch here. So we basically were able to find through OpenRocket the diameter that we wanted for it to be. And then we just started based off the diameter. We started with that and then used like illustrations from the 60s about like what size and dimensions to make everything else. Yeah. So there's a bunch of research in here and a couple of sketches of the balut. Yeah, that's what we were looking at.
The next I'll shoot about all of that versus the rocket was going to do that.
Was that for the nose cone?
Okay.
Oh, maybe this was an inverted cone.
Yeah.
Oh, yep.
Yeah, okay.
It wouldn't get her to relabel some stuff.
So that's distribution here, a YouTube form. So YouTube form is basically where our bomb is.
Right.
CFD. I did CFD for balut testing, just for balut shapes before we decided on the actual balut shapes. The final balut shape. Yeah. But just like testing for like different shapes like a cone versus a sphere versus like the normal teardrop or like the normal teardrop shape or like something with like a donut shape like it. Mm-hmm. There is a CFD paper I wrote for my final report that is, yeah, it's in there.
Good. Cool. Okay, great. So that's what we'll look at when we think about this again, okay. Yeah.
And Wazer is just all of the files that we needed. Wazer.
The cut, okay.
Yeah. That is just the naming convention will definitely be changed later or can be changed later. It's just named right like that for now because Ike required an appendix B and I just gave him the link to that because that's where all of our calculations are, all of our tables, all of our design documents, and all of our design documents. All of our calculations, tables, and all of our drawings.
So. Are those the MathCAD things?
Yes, all the MathCAD things.
Okay.
Oh, real quick, the CFD actually pointed us to the direction of like this traditional balut shape too. It kind of supported basically that this was the right way to go.
This does have a ring around the outside.
Does it does. Verbal fence.
Yeah. Oh, it does. Oh, that's
it does. Yeah. Right here.
So many verbals.
Yeah. Too many verbals.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. As a note, there are in the CAD, there are drawings for pretty much all of our parts. They're not super great drawings because I just needed to get them in, but they are there. I would recommend like if it's for machining, definitely like looking through them and editing them.
Yeah. That's the numbers. Okay.
Where is it? Did I send you a PDF?
I just looked. Also, a lot of our testing and videos are all in the SpringTerm media folder. So pictures of us doing like balloon testing, of us doing parachute test, like the flying test, and things like that.
I guess I was forgot to mention. So for the balloon testing, because we like asked around Portland and no one was like dumb enough to be like, yeah, you can drop things off a building. Mm-hmm. We decided to do a couple different things. So we first did running around in a circle.
Yep.
And then we, without asking, dropped it from the inside of the engineering building.
Yep.
And then from there, Dr. Cal saw us and was like super excited that we were breaking rules and was like, how about if you do this correctly? And so that's how we got access to the wind tunnel. So
that's great.
The future lessons learned, always break the rules.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And fun. Yes. Break the rules first, apologize later. Yeah, exactly.
And then I wanted to show, because Leslie did a really great poster, but
you would think
part of what's really great from it is that it has a really helpful diagram of like how everything goes together. So because we recognize that our system is a little bit confusing, but like if for future can like look at and see like this is how things are supposed to go out, these are how things are labeled.
Great.
That's that. Yeah, so this is just something to make sure is looked at.
Cool. You get your poster. Don't forget we get your poster.
Oh, I gave it to you. I slapped it to you.
With a physical print. Did you guys?
No, we didn't because we're not design pair. I thought you wanted to print it.
Yeah,
we are the worst, but I thought you were going to print it. Good.
So everybody has to make a poster even if you don't print it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's required. Yeah, we're going to print.
But this is just kind of helpful to see that this is our first blue that we had mm-hmm. Blackstar make and testing it. And there's like the wind tunnel definitely was the best test to see it inflating. And like the top was fairly inflated. Let's see. Might be kind of loud.
I think this one doesn't get started very quickly, so you may want to skip.
Like you can tell that it's inflated, but not staying everywhere.
Right, it's not stable.
Yeah. So that's why we made the far end, the orange end. Yeah. We made it much more open, and then we had the ram air inlets on the side be made more symmetrical. So they're perfect now. So we have high hopes for this.
So we should try that. I assume you're not going to get a chance to try it in the wind tunnel before you're gone.
I don't know when that would be.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Okay. Oh, is that true?
Probably as well.
Okay. Okay. Do we have the contact information for the Blackstar people?
Yep. And pattern.
So when you do the big box.
Did you open it yet? This came from the person who actually sewed it. And she said that any person who knows sewing will know exactly what to do with this.
Okay.
But this is the pattern for this size and it can be scaled up.
Wow.
And she said she's available to work on it again. Like she enjoyed it. So yeah.
Not every day you make a supersonic value.
Yeah. This is very valuable because people wanted to charge us $10,000 to make a balloon. Yeah. So. Oh, it's inside. Thank you. What did you say?
No, it's not worth scanning. It's got to be the right scale.
Oh, that's not.
Okay.
Yeah, we can scan it.
Put a reference marker picture of it.
Okay.
So yeah, that's that.
Good.
And since this is open source, it'd be nice to share this with other people too. Because
yes, okay.
Can we do other little paper fishing parts?
Oh, that's probably good. Okay.
Yep.
Okay, so this is awesome. I want to make sure that we've got Blackstar contacts somewhere easy to find. That should that could be. Well, we don't want to put that in the final report, I guess. Yeah, they're a public company.
They're in the final report.
Okay.
Already.
Great.
Yeah. All right. So let's quickly scroll through this and then let you guys go. All right. Hold on. Okay. Stop. Nope. Too far. Stop. Executive summary, client summary, highlights. Yes, good. Okay. Keep going. Okay, good. Yep. Okay. Yep, now just kind of scroll through. Good. Okay. Faster. Yeah, subsystems. Okay, good. Hey, this is right. The blue chapel. Yeah. Awesome. And thank you for not making it 230
freaking
pages.
You're welcome.
All right. Okay, good.
Cool. And then all of the appendices.
And all the references, you guys, all the PDFs are in the resources folder.
Yeah.
Okay. I think you guys are good.
Cool. Thank you.
Any other questions? Any other things?
Yay!
One last thing I'll ask is that someone takes a little bit of time to organize all the current ERS stuff and put it on the shelves with nice labels and everything.
Yeah, we pretty much did over half of that, so we'll finish it up.
Do you want us to take it apart? We are using the most things on the wall.
No. I think I almost want it together. I think
but it's good for demonstration,
to show it.
To show how this works.
The only thing I'll ask is that let's put it in that corner so someone doesn't knock it. Oh, let me stop recording. All right. Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.